morning.
Good morning.
I want to welcome you to our worship service here at Westside Baptist Church. I'd like to have you take the registration pads that are at the end of the pew and sign those. Before you do that, or if you've already done that, in a couple weeks, we'll have the Christmas breakfast, and they're trying to get a count of those who will be attending on December 3rd. And Lana, I'm just going to verify the time. It's 8:45. Is that right? 9 o'clock. What is the time?
Is it 8:45 or 9?
Do you know what time the breakfast is? It's on the calendar as 8:45. Okay. All right. So sign up if you're planning on attending. Give a number. Also, we have several other announcements. If you ordered a pie from the youth group, we were busy making pies yesterday. And so those pies are in fellowship. No, those hot pies are in Homer Hall. And you can pick yours up after church. I picked up a long piece of paper, so hang on a second. Okay, so I'm moving right along. Coolers, if you brought a cooler because of all the chickens and the turkeys we gave away this last Wednesday, they are available to be picked up if you haven't already. They're in the gym. Is that right? Okay. They've moved to the right outside this door, right outside the elevator. So if you have a cooler that you brought for that, you can pick it up. Next Sunday is Hanging of the Greens after church. Mark isn't in the here right now, but there is a movie night coming up on December 9th on Saturday. It's in your bulletin, so take a look at that. This is the last day for poinsettia orders. Also, this past week, Colleen and I were just sitting there watching TV one evening, and she's channel surfing, and she flips, and Tom, can you flip that up? And we run across, and we see somebody's on TV, and Colleen said, "Wow, that looks like Don Johnson." She went back, and she said, "Wow, that is Don Johnson." So Don, he's looking down, and he's not looking up at me, but I'm talking about you. We have a picture. So Don and his granddaughter were on Wheel of Fortune, and they did a really good job. If you missed it, it was pretty entertaining to watch. And patio cushions, I don't know how she got that. That was an amazing amazing feat.
Now we're all his best friends.
Yes.
I also want to mention he gave his testimony on TV when he was doing that.
We missed that.
Yeah, we didn't catch it at the beginning. Don didn't tell us anything. He kept a secret. He's probably supposed to keep a secret. Also listed in the News and the Pews, the pastor's Christmas cookie party, they've got the time and date for that. And I think that Jan is behind me, right? And she has an announcement she wants to make.
I've decided that something special for the women of the church for the first, what is the day of the 5th? December 5th, which would be Ladies' Night Out on a regular time. I'm inviting all of the women, and if the men want to tack along, that's fine too. For Ladies' Night Out at my house, and we live in the Potwood area, so you'll be able to see all of the lights and on your way over or on the way back. So anyone who wants to come, sign up on the bulletin board and bring a finger food, nothing elaborate. So I will welcome all of the women in our church. Thank you.
And we can tag along, right? You said that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Then
so, and if your appetite's really big, guys, and you need something before, you might want to eat something before, because finger food may not fill us all up. All right, do we have any other announcements that need to be made? Becky?
Yes, I have a
reminder, the silent auction is also going to be at the breakfast next month. And anybody that's willing to donate something for the auction, a basket or gift item, something that you would like to share with the youth, it's a fundraiser for them. And please come and share the auction also. Thank you.
Okay, so there will be activities for all the kids on Hanging of the Greens, and kids will have crafts as well. So we'll decorate the sanctuary, and if the kids are here for their Sunday school rooms, there's some decorations for the rooms. We can do that at that time also. Any other announcements? If not, why don't you get up and greet one another? If you don't know somebody, introduce yourself.
Thank you. recording this test is which instruments here.
Oh. you love us, and that you call us your children, and that you pour out your blessings upon us. And so, Lord, receive our praise this day and every day of the year for being a wonderful God. Come into our worship, we pray, through your Spirit and in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hear the word of the Lord coming to us from the book of Judges, a text about Deborah, a judge of the Lord, found in Judges 4, verses 1 through 7. After Ehud died, the Israelites once again did evil in the eyes of the Lord, which means that they went out and worshipped other gods, not the God of Israel. So the Lord sold them into the hand of Jabin, the king of Canaan, who reigned in Horeb. The commander of his army was Sisera, who lived in Harosheth Hagoyim. Because he had 900 iron chariots and had cruelly oppressed the Israelites for 20 years, they cried to the Lord for help. Deborah, a prophetess, the wife of Lahiboth, was leading Israel at the time. She had court under the palm of Deborah between Ram and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim, and the Israelites came to her to have their disputes decided. She sent for Barak, son of Abiom, from Kadesh in Naphtali, and said to him, "The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go take with you 10,000 men of Naphtali and Zebulun, and lead the way to Mount Tabor. I will lure Sisera and the commander of Jabin's army with his chariots and his troops to the Kishon River and give him into your hands."
I'm reading from the fifth chapter of 1 Thessalonians. "When is all of this going to happen? I really don't need to say anything about that, dear brothers. For you know perfectly well that no one knows, for that day the Lord will come unexpectedly, like a thief in the night. When people are saying, all is well, everything is quiet and peaceful, then all of a sudden disaster will fall upon them as suddenly as a woman's birth pains when her child is born. And these people will not be able to get away anywhere. There will be no place to hide. But dear brothers, you are not in the dark about these things, and you won't be surprised as by a thief when that day of the Lord comes. For you are all children of the light and of the day, and do not belong to darkness and night. Be on your guard, not asleep like the others. Watch for his return and stay sober. Night is the time for sleep and the time when people get drunk. But let us who live in the light keep sober, protected by the armor of faith and love, and wearing as our helmet the happy hope of salvation. For God has not chosen to pour out his anger upon us, but to save us through our Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us, so that we can live with him forever. Whether we are dead or alive at the time of his return. So encourage each other and build each other up, just as you are already doing." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now, if you want to turn to page 649, we're going to sing stanzas 1 and 2 of Gather Us In.
Our fears and our griefs, God, here to you and what a light of this.
Today we come before the Lord to give him praise and thanks, and also to petition God, who is good. I know that there are prayer requests printed in the bulletin, and so I encourage you to take these out. Abed Kirby was in the hospital with an infection, with bronchitis and pneumonia. Praise God, the antibiotics worked quickly, and he was able to go home. So continue to pray for Reg, but also pray for Karen, who is having a lot of pain with her feet and her back. And also continue to lift up to Janet, as she is the one taking care of both of them 24 hours a day. And so she even slept at the hospital in the room so that she could make sure that Reg was being taken care of. Also, we continue to pray for Hilda, who has bronchitis. She has moved to Brewster Place Rehab. And we also want to lift up others who are in need. I know that Jan Mock has bronchitis, and I'm really glad that she was willing to come and to do, as she said, her duties, and now she's going home. And so please continue to pray for her. And also, many of you remember Bruce Johnson. Bruce Johnson was a member here, a music director. He had a heart attack and some type of event. They can't say exactly. They think it might have been a stroke. Last night, and he is expected to pass away today. And so please be praying for Mary Lou and all of the family. Are there other prayer requests or praises that you have to share? Kara?
My boyfriend Michael's dad fell on Tuesday in his home and broke his hip. They didn't need to replace the whole hip, but he has problems with it, so he finally found a surgeon that would do it. So he got a total hip replacement on Wednesday night, and that went fine, so he's in Kansas Rehab Hospital, but we'll pray that he gets to go home in a week or two. And Mike's an only son, so it's pretty much just him, so pray for him too. And then when I was walking over, the neighbor was asking me to pray for them, so pray that they come to church.
Yes. Thank you, Tara. We will be praying for Michael's dad. Other prayer requests and praises?
I have a praise for a, I don't know what I'm trying to say. A process that we do here at church. And I took a vacation day Wednesday and came down to work with Clarence on the WWW. And the whole process of a meal preparation for WWW, he does that every Wednesday. Maybe not as early as we did that day, but he's here most of the day on Wednesday. And then I got to go down to the harvesters with Ivan to go pick up the food and put it all downstairs and the whole distribution piece of it. And it's a praise that, and give God the glory that our partnership with harvesters is helping a lot. I know you can give the tonnage of food that's been given away, but it's a lot. And it was just, if you ever have the opportunity to come on a Wednesday to help Clarence and go through that process, it's a pretty neat deal.
We had 75 families come through the food distribution on Wednesday. We gave out 56 turkeys and 30-some chickens. And the tonnage was about 1,000 pounds of food went out of the church on Wednesday alone to 75 families. Thank you, Brooks.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Yeah. Other praises and prayer requests. All right, let us pray. God, you are so good to us. We come to thank you, O Lord, for your generosity and your love, to praise you for your glory and beauty, to acknowledge, O Lord, that you are the great King of the universe. And as your children, we say thank you, Father, for the way that you take care of us. Lord, we thank you for your mercy and grace that you have extended not only to the Jews, but to Gentiles and to everyone, O Lord, who is willing to come to you. We praise you for your loving kindness, that when we come, you do not give us a long list of all the things that we've done wrong, O Lord, but you speak to us words of truth with forgiveness. You, O Lord, confront our moral wrong with your mercy. And Lord, we are grateful. We are grateful that as children we can continue to grow and to mature and to be with you and all of the saints who are in glory. Father, as we come this day, we say thank you. Thank you for the farmers who rise early. Thank you for the cooks who come here early, O Lord, to help with food. Thank you, O Lord, for every hand that helps food come to our tables, to the people who are stacking groceries, to the people who check us out, and Lord, to those who are willing to share out of the bounty of their own produce. God, we thank you for our leaders. Lord, I thank you for our church leaders and their commitment to come and to proclaim, O Lord, their commitment to generosity here at our congregation. And Lord, thank you that you are the one who provides our needs. We come, O Lord, with Bryce and Bruce and Michael's father. We bring to you, O Lord, Reg and Hilda and Dawn. We ask, O Lord, that you put your hand on Esther. Bring healing to this church, to our neighbors, to our world, and to the nations. God, we thank you for the opportunity to bear witness to our faith, the goodness that you have shown to us in Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, you have asked and said that whatever we ask in your name, you will do. And so, Lord, we would like everyone in the Wardney neighborhood to become a Christian, Lord, and to follow you, to have Christ in every home, and that every child would know about you, O Lord, and bring you praise. Father, we bring to you also our concerns for our world. We pray for our president and our nation. We lift up to you our general secretary, our executive minister, and the executive minister search committee, Lord, asking that you guide us to the right person for this time. And God, we also come saying thank you. Thank you for the healing that you are giving to people with bronchitis. Thank you for the healing that you are giving. And thank you for your spirit, which is present, O Lord, in our last hour. We pray, O Lord, that you help all who are grieving to find hope in the resurrection and to have comfort by your Holy Spirit. For, Lord, we know that you will do these things because you are good. And it is in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. I invite our ushers forward to receive our offering. Today we are going to receive our offering, our normal offering, and then later in the service we will bring our commitment cards, our pledge cards, our estimated giving cards forward as part of our worship service. But as our ushers come forward, let us give thanks. Thank you, Father, for all gifts that you have given to us through Christ our Lord. little children come to me and Angie. Gonna have to come over here. I want to introduce you guys to one of my friends. This is Angie, soon to be the Reverend Dr. Angie Jackson, I hope. She's a student at Central Seminary, and today she has come to help us with our story and with our message. So welcome, Angie.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here. Just a word to the adults. This may be different than your normal practice, I'm not sure, but the children's time this morning is essential for you as well. So don't use this time to take a power nap. If you're a fan of the theater or the stage, think of the children's time as Act One this morning. If you're a reader, this is the prologue to the sermon. Or if you're a movie watcher, this is the prequel. So if you don't pay attention now, you're going to be lost later. I am a former teacher and now turned preacher, so I love books and stories. And so I brought one of my favorite books to share with you this morning, and it just so happens that that it's a really good picture of the scripture as well. So I'm going to invite you for the next few moments to join me in the telling of the story, Stone Soup. Three soldiers trudged down a road in a strange country. They were on their way home from the wars, and besides being tired, they were hungry. In fact, they had eaten nothing for 2 whole days. "How I would like a good dinner tonight," said the first, "and a bed to sleep in," said the second. "But all that is impossible," said the third. "We must march on." And on they marched. Suddenly ahead of them, they saw the lights of a village. "Maybe we'll find a bite to eat there," said the first. "And a loft to sleep in," said the second. "No harm in asking," said the third. Now the peasants of that place feared strangers. When they heard that three soldiers were coming down the road, they talked among themselves. "Here come soldiers. Soldiers are always hungry, you know. But we have little enough for ourselves," and they hurried to hide all their food. They pushed sacks of barley under the hay in the lofts. They lowered buckets of milk down the wells. They spread old quilts over the carrot bins. They hid their cabbages and potatoes under the beds. They hung their meat in the cellars. They hid all they had to eat, and then they waited. The soldiers stopped first at the house of Paul and Francois. "Good evening to you," they said. "Could you spare a bit of food for 3 hungry soldiers? "We've had no food for ourselves for 3 days, said Paul. Francois made a sad face. "It's been a poor harvest." The three soldiers went on to the house of Albert and Louise. "Could you spare a bit of food and have you some corner where we could sleep for the night?" "Oh, no," said Albert. "We gave all we could spare to the soldiers who came before you." "Our beds are full," said Louise. At Vincent and Marie's, the answer was the same. It had been a poor harvest, and all the grain must be kept for seed. So it went all through the village. Not a peasant had any food to give away. They all had good reasons. One family had used the grain for feed. Another had an old sick father to care for. All had too many mouths to fill. The villagers stood in the street and sighed. They looked as hungry as they could. The three soldiers talked together. Then the first soldier called out, "Good people!" And the peasants drew near. "We are 3 hungry soldiers in a strange land. We have asked you for food, and you have no food. Well then, we'll have to make stone soup." The peasants stared. Stone soup, that would be something to know about. "First, we'll need a large iron pot," the soldier said. The peasants brought the largest pot they could find. "How else to cook enough?" "That's none too large," said the soldiers, "but it will do. And now, water to fill it and a fire to heat it. It took many buckets of water to fill the pot. A fire was built on the village square and the pot was set to boil. And now, if you please, three round, smooth stones. Those were easy enough to find. David, I think there's some stones up there on the table. You want to grab them and you guys can pass them around and feel how smooth they are? Those were easy enough to find. The peasants' eyes grew round as they watched the soldiers drop the stones into the pot. Something special about smooth stones, I think. Any soup needs salt and pepper, said the soldiers as they began to stir, and so children ran to fetch the salt and pepper. Do we have salt and pepper on the table? Want to see? Go check and see if there's salt and pepper on the table. Stones like these generally make good soup, but oh, if there were carrots, it would be so much better. And you found the salt and pepper. Fabulous. Why, I think I have a carrot or two, said Francois, and off she ran. And she came back with her apron full of carrots from the bin beneath the quilt. A good stone soup should have cabbage, said the soldiers as they sliced the carrots into the pot. But no use asking for what you haven't got. I think I can find a cabbage somewhere, said Marie, and she hurried home. And back she came with three cabbages on the cover under the bed. If only we had a bit of beef and a few potatoes, this soup would be good enough for a rich man's table. The peasants thought that over. They remembered their potatoes and the sides of beef hanging in the cellars, and they ran to fetch them. A rich man's soup, and all from a few stones. It seemed like magic. Ah, sighed the soldiers as they stirred in the beef and potatoes. If only we had a little barley and a cup of milk, the soup would be fit for the king himself. Indeed, he asked for such a soup when he last dined with us. The peasants looked at each other. The soldiers had entertained the king well. But no use asking for what you haven't got, the soldiers sighed. The peasants brought their barley from the lofts. They brought their milk from the wells. The soldiers stirred the barley and the milk into the steaming broth while the peasants stared. At last, the soup was ready. All of you shall taste, the soldier said, but first a table must be set. Your mom made you set the table at home? You have to set the table. Great tables were placed in the square and all around lighted torches. Such a soup, how good it smelled, truly fit for a king. But then the peasants asked themselves, would not such a soup require bread and a roast and cider? And soon a banquet was spread and everyone sat down to eat. Never had there been such a feast. Never had the peasants tasted such soup and fixed made from stones. They ate and drank and ate and drank, and after that, they danced. They danced and sang into the night. At last, they were tired, and then the three soldiers asked, is there not a loft where we can sleep? Let three such wise and splendid gentlemen sleep in a loft? Indeed, they must have the best beds in the village. And so the first soldier slept in the priest's house, the pastor's house. The second soldier slept in the baker's house, and the third soldier slept in the mayor's house. And in the morning, the whole village gathered in the square to give them a send-off. Many thanks for what you have taught us, the peasants said to the soldiers. We shall never go hungry now that we know how to make soup from stones. Isn't that a fabulous story? Have you made stone soup before? No? Well, I have a sheet for you today, and it's got a scripture put on them, so why don't I send those down? And I want us to just read one of these verses, because we're going to read the whole scripture here in a moment, but This is from 1 Timothy. And in verse 18, it says, tell the rich people to do good and to be rich in doing good deeds. Tell them to be happy to give and ready to share. What did these villagers do that's in this Bible verse? They shared, right? And what would have happened if they had not shared? Okay, the soldiers would have been hungry, right? They would have been marching and marching to another village. And you know what? I think about those villagers, though. Imagine if you were the person with carrots and you didn't share with everybody else. What would you have to eat? Just carrots, right? And what if you were the person with potatoes and you didn't share with everybody else? What would you have to eat?
Potatoes.
Just potatoes, right? Well, you could do it different ways. You could mash them one day, I guess make french fries another, but you just have potatoes, and after a while, you wouldn't want potatoes anymore, right? And what about onions? What if you were the people with the onions?
Ew.
And you didn't share with everybody? You would have to eat onions for breakfast and for lunch and for dinner. Dragon breath, you are right. So this village learned a lesson, right? Because when you share, who benefits from sharing? Was it just the soldiers that got a meal that they didn't have? Who benefited? The whole village, right? That's right. The whole village benefited. I want you to think about something this morning. I want you to think about this church and how it's your village. Okay? And when everybody shares, who benefits? Everybody, right? The whole village. So I want you to remember that every village, whether it's your church village or your family village or your school village or the Topeka village, every village is better when we share with each other, right? We're more like God's kingdom when we share, okay? Can you remember that? Okay, let's pray quickly, and then you all may go where you go, okay? God, we love you. Help us to share ourselves and our stuff with each other and our world. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for being here today and sharing this story with me.
You can put those stones back up. Thank you.
This morning's reading is from Paul's first letter to Timothy, chapter 6, verses 17 to 19. As for those who in the present age are rich, command them not to be haughty or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous and ready to share, thus storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of the life that really is life. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Shall we pray for just a moment before we spend some time in the word? Lord our God, open our eyes that we might see you. Open our ears that we might hear your word. Open our hearts and minds that we might be transformed in your likeness. Through Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Well, thank you for welcoming me among you this morning, and especially for the particular joy of sharing the word. I am delighted to be here, and as I told you already, the former teacher in me gets very excited about literature, and as a preacher and a lover of the scripture, I get excited about that too. So when I can bring two of them together, I get downright giddy, and so that's where I find myself this morning. I'm going to invite you to consider three themes that are found not only in our text, but also in our story. And I'd like us to look at those themes and see how they serve as points of transformation, both in the story and also in our lives. Now, the three themes are significant individually, but what I really want us to consider is what happens when the three of them come together. Because it's powerful stuff. And good things happen. In fact, an entire community changed before our eyes in the stone soup story. The first theme I'd like us to think about this morning is humility. Our text began with these words, command them not to be haughty, not to be prideful or full of themselves. Before a community of faith can live into God's plan and purpose for it, there must be an appropriate view of self. Paul talks about these things in other places too. In Romans, he says it like this, don't think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. And C.S. Lewis, the Christian writer, said it this way, humility is not thinking less of yourself, but thinking of yourself less. Humility is essential and foundational for being transformed into Christ's likeness. Jesus himself was the ultimate example of humility. If we consider Paul's words again, Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited. But he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient, even unto death, death on a cross. Transformation and humility appear to go hand in hand. I think that perhaps one can't be transformed without being humble, and one cannot truly be humble without a bit of transformation to get us there. Our little stone soup village has been transformed in this way. Think about the villagers who, at the outset of the story, are suspicious and fearful of the soldiers. Their priority is on self-preservation, having enough for themselves. And it's this self-focus that leads them to hide all of their food. That way they don't have to share it. They seem a little haughty, don't they? Their preservation is more important to them than feeding the strangers. And this kind of self-focus made them fearful instead of welcoming. It left them isolated with their doors closed and their windows shuttered. And think about this, they were closed off not only to outsiders, but also to each other. It's not until they begin to humbly offer the ingredients for the soup that the village begins to change. Humility. Having a proper view of one's status, not more important or less important than others. This is the first evidence that our little village will be transformed. And by the end of the story, they have humbly let go of their suspicions and their self-preservation, and they offer the very best beds in the village to the soldiers. Haylofts and corners just will not do because they hold these men in such high regard. They've elevated their status above their own. So they must sleep in the home of the village's most respected leaders. The second theme that I see, I'm going to call community today, but the text calls it sharing. And I'd like us to think again about our little village. The people who began as these suspicious, fearful, self-focused individuals morphed into humble, generous parts of a whole. Individuals at the beginning and parts of a whole by the end. Their transformation was made possible not only by their humility, but it was this connection and proximity that they experienced with others, in particular, people of whom they were suspicious and fearful. People who were outsiders and different from them. Whereas their attitudes and assumptions at the beginning had rendered them isolated, hiding themselves and all their stuff inside their homes, closing their doors, closing their hearts. But when those attitudes shifted, the people changed dramatically. You can picture it, can't you? Our villagers began opening their doors, opening their cellars and their cupboards, opening their minds to new possibilities. They opened their hearts and their lives to vulnerability, to sharing their friendship and their precious resources with others. In these villagers, I see a theme that Paul weaves in other places in the New Testament. Though there were many of them, they were one body, and individually they belonged to each other. Once they realized that belonging to one another did not mean losing pieces of themselves or going without, but instead gaining from one another, like we talked with the children. It wasn't just the soldiers that got fed, but everybody got fed, and they were fed beyond their wildest imaginations. Eating and drinking and dancing. When I read that story, I can almost hear the music. Can't you hear it? And the sounds of clinking glasses and tapping feet and clapping hands and shouts and laughter. These are party sounds. Our villagers were transformed by community. They became a living testimony of this good works and sharing that Paul talks about in this letter to Timothy. Perhaps some of you are familiar with the South African philosophy known as Ubuntu. Those of you at the meeting on Tuesday, I gave you this hint for today. Bishop Desmond Tutu talks about Ubuntu in this way. My humanity is bound up in yours, for we can only be human together. A core tenet of this philosophy is a person is a person through other people. It's the idea that I am because we are. I'm not fully me without you, and you are not fully you without me. This is a profound truth, friends. We don't see it a whole lot in American culture or American Christianity, but I cannot think of a better time for us to embrace this notion that the early church was very familiar with. We belong to each other. A community has the power to transform our individual lives, our churches, and our larger communities. To be transformed by sharing ourselves in community may be the linchpin on which our transformation into the likeness of Christ hinges. Think about it for a minute. It's impossible to become loving, sacrificial, humble, compassionate, kind, patient, generous, grateful, peacemaking, merciful, all of these things we associate with Christ, without living in connection and proximity to others. Other people sharpen us. They help us become better. Our call to share ourselves is also not a call just to gather with like-minded folks or those who we really, really enjoy their company or people with whom we share social status or political affiliation or even common interests. The people that we like and get along with great and agree upon everything with, they don't change us very much. But when we spend time with strangers, when we rub shoulders with people we don't know or don't know very well, people with whom we disagree, people who just irritate the heck out of us, these are the interactions that shape us into the likeness of Christ and give us opportunities to become more like Jesus. In isolation, comfort, and security, we will never become all that God has created and purposed us to be. So when we share our lives with others in mutual giving and receiving, and we become more like God because God exists this way all the time. This is the Trinitarian example. God exists as a living communion. God is creator, redeemer, and sustainer all the time, ever giving, ever receiving, ever sharing. And God is never diminished or reduced by giving God's self away. And we are never diminished or reduced when we give ourselves away either. Love and goodness given away always make more of themselves. We don't lose ourselves to communion with others, but instead, like we shared with the children, we gain because we become better versions of ourselves, and then whole becomes better for that as well. The third and final theme that I'd like us to explore for a couple of moments is generosity. Our villagers were transformed by generosity. Remember again, in the beginning, they hid all of their resources and they hid themselves in their homes. But by the end of the story, not only had they flung open their homes and cupboards and hearts to the visitors. Initially, they were unwilling even to share a single potato or a pile of hay. And yet by the end, we had them bringing aprons full and cupboards full and buckets full. Their very best beds. Transformed from self-centered and self-preserving to lavishly and joyously generous. This is something that I love. There was not only soup, but a feast. And there was not only feast, but a party. Not only polite conversation, but there was dancing and singing. The town became a place of great joy and celebration. They took hold of the life that really is life. And if I didn't know better, I'd think that they were familiar with Notre Dame University's Generosity Project. The researchers there detailed their research in a book called The Paradox of Generosity. They interviewed and gave surveys to hundreds of Americans, and what they found is really powerful and is life-changing. Did you know they proved scientifically that generous people are happier and healthier than ungenerous people? They used 10% as the measuring stick for generosity. I wonder where they came up with that one. And the people who regularly, with discipline and commitment, gave themselves their time, their personhood, and their resources away experienced more overall well-being in their lives than those
students who did not. Tithers reported the greatest overall contentment and satisfaction, happiness of any group, and the highest levels of physical health. That means less disease, less aches and pains, but vitality. They scientifically demonstrated what our religious teachers from traditions around the world have been teaching us for millennia. We know from the Hebrew scriptures, one man gives freely yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly but ends up impoverished. Giving brings happiness at every stage of its expression. Buddha said that. The Hindu proverbs say, they who give have all things, they who withhold have nothing. And of course, we're familiar with Jesus. Whoever tries to keep his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life will preserve it. Giving is good for us. Science has proven it. And we want to be healthier and happier, don't we? Generosity is front and center today in this place as you all prepare to make your pledges, your commitments for next year. And generosity will determine, in large part, your church's future. So these are Paul's instructions to Timothy, but they're also instructive for Westside this morning. Don't think too highly of yourselves or your earthly riches. Instead, set your hopes on God, who abundantly provides for the earth and her inhabitants. Expend your energy on doing good and sharing yourselves with others. Be rich in good works and generous in all things. By doing so, you store up a treasure for eternity and take hold of the life that really is life. For your church to be all that God purposes it to be, every single person must contribute what God has called them and enabled them to give. I invite you to think just a bit this morning about how some of you are in financial positions to provide the foundational structure for this church's ministry. So if we think about our story, some of you are called to be the pot, to provide the resources in which everyone else's go to feed the village, right? Others of you may have fewer resources, but you are still called to contribute. The soup was not soup without the vegetables, the meat, the barley, and the milk. And those with least resources are not off the hook. Did you notice in the story that the children ran to get the salt and pepper? And the soup would have lacked flavor without the tiniest grains of seasoning. No gift matters more necessarily than the other. No gift is unimportant. They all work together to make the soup. And of course, beyond your financial contributions, God calls you to be generous with yourselves in leadership and creativity and talent. And perhaps you're the salt and pepper in one realm, but you are the soup pot in another. You're all called to live generous lives. God desires that you all would take hold of the life that really is life. If you have yet to experience a transformation of generosity in your own life, there is good news. It can be cultivated. The research says if one commits to give and does it over and over again, they grow to be more generous. If you want to become generous, they say, then start acting generous. By the end of our story, our villagers had truly discovered and taken hold of this life that Paul talked about with Timothy. They didn't just eat soup, but they enjoyed a feast. They didn't just throw a party, but they laughed and sang and danced into the night. They took hold of this life because they allowed themselves to be transformed by who humility, by community, and by generosity. And my prayer for you all this morning and in the coming year is that you may experience this trio of transformation. That Westside Baptist Church might be known for its humility, its sense of community, and its overflowing generosity. And may you all, together and individually, take hold of the life that really is life. Amen.
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 Today is our Commitment Sunday, which we will bring forward our pledge cards, our estimate and giving cards, and put them in the soup pot, the perfect place for them to go. And so as I invite the ushers forward, the ushers will come forward and give a card to each family. I encourage you to fill this out. It is part of our own expression and participation in worship. If you don't want to, you don't have to. No one is going to require you, and no one is going to contact you if your card is blank. But as the ushers come forward, I want to share with you the great joy of giving. We have received 56 turkeys this last week, and we were able to share them with people who were coming to the food pantry. And it was great joy handing these turkeys out. And at the end, we had a couple extra. And so, go ahead, hand those out. So we had a couple extra, and so I prayed to the Lord, "Lord, what should I do with these?" And God told me to take them to one of our neighbors. And so I just carried a turkey down the street, and I knocked on the door, and the person answered, and I told them that God wanted me to share a turkey with them, and the family started crying. They just started crying, and that was not the first family who started crying when we shared a turkey, and they said, "We have nothing." We were facing Thanksgiving not without a turkey, but nothing at all. And so from that, it encouraged me to come back and get a few more things and take it down to them. And then others found out about it, other neighbors, and they started sharing. And that just really touched me. Another person who came through to get food said, "You know what? This is what church is all about. Being generous, being loving, and being kind. We're glad you're in our neighborhood." And so our church is really becoming an example of generosity and love to all of our neighbors. And it's because of all of you. It's all of you. So thank you for sharing your riches. Thank you for sharing your time. And thank you to all the people who do a lot of work around here for sharing your energy. As we sing our song, we're going to come forward, and I invite you in good, decent order to come down the middle aisles and return to your seats on the outer aisles. So come down the middle aisles, go back to your seats on the outer aisle. If you cannot come down, then simply share your card with someone who can bring it forward for you. And I encourage you to come as children with families. If you are with a family, come forward as we sing. And we will put them in the pot, we will dedicate them to the Lord, and we pray that God will enrich our lives. So would you please stand with me and sing hymn number 685, and as we're singing, bring your cards forward.
Thank you.
given. And Lord, today we pray that you place your hands upon all that we have, and Lord, we consecrate them to you as we dedicate ourselves to the evangelization and social justice in this world. Come, Lord, and hear our prayer of thanksgiving today, every day, and on Thursday. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Our closing hymn will be hymn number 40. For the beauty of the earth, we'll sing stanza 1 and 2. Let us sing to the Lord. Spirit be with you all. Go, my brothers and sisters, transform the world with love.